trying to blast their music.
Good. How are you?
Good.
A little warmer in here, too.
Yes, it is. That's funny.
Delivery. I'm all right. Nobody but about me. Why you got to give me a fight? Can't you just let it be?
Hello.
Yep. Perfect right there, Garrett. Nope. I can't hear Cam.
I loved playing high school sports. I loved the competition, the camaraderie, the bands, the crowds, all the pageantry, and I wanted to keep playing. But I graduated. No colleges called, and neither did the pros. So, to stay close to the game I loved, I decided to become a high school official. You know, a referee. When I played high school sports, I learned the importance of integrity, good sportsmanship, and respect for the rules. Now, as a high school official, I get to help model these same values to others. Maybe the colleges and the pros didn't call, but the kids in Texas did. And now, I'm enjoying the competition, the camaraderie, the bands, the crowds, and all the pageantry of high school sports all over again.
Interested in becoming a licensed high school official? Go to highschoolofficials.com to learn more and begin the application process.
Good evening and welcome to this football game between the Groom Tigers and the Silverton Owls. This game is being conducted according to the rules and regulations of the University Interscholastic League. Regardless of the outcome of tonight's game, all of the players have proven their willingness to work and sacrifice in order to achieve athletic excellence. We ask that as a spectator, you consider the time and effort each of these teams, coaches, and athletes.
It's time for Groom Tiger football. Get ready for the exciting world of six-man football, high scoring, and never-ending excitement. And now, the area's most listened-to broadcast team in six-man, the TNT Package, Tim Case and Tony Rocha.
Back together, it's like the band broke up.
Yeah, I decided to let Tony come to the game tonight.
You know what? It's great to be back home, getting to call the game. Back, Tim and I mean, Tim had some things that needed to get taken care of the last few weeks, and, you know, thanks to everybody that filled in. And the two guys at Miami, Randy and Chad, they got their hands full again tonight because this is the second game of district play. And tonight you got the Tigers versus the Silverton Owls, and this is going to be more than likely –
yes.
1-2 in the district.
Yeah, this should be for the district championship. Both these guys are undefeated so far, 1-0 in district play. So it's going to be very critical to determine where you're going to end up in the postseason after tonight's game.
Yeah, it's kind of it's like deja vu from last year. I mean, same thing. You know, we went down to Silverton, and here it was. You know, they're playing for the 1 and 2 position. But so we're gonna go. We're gonna start with the coach's corner, and we got a little special tonight. I filled in for JJ because he's been having to take class. But we have a special guest. We have Jennifer Pete and Jackie Riley for Coach's Corner. We're going to turn it over to that there. All right, that's another edition of Coach's Corner. You've got Tony Rocha filling in for the great JJ Ubarra. He's kind of been kind of busy this week, so I'm filling in. But today we have a special surprise for everybody. We have Mrs. Coach Pete, Mrs. Coach Riley, otherwise known as Jennifer, and Jackie Riley. Ladies, thank you for joining in.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. First question. So how long have you been a coach's wife? Who wants to go first?
I guess I will since I'm the old lady.
No, you're not.
Joe has been in coaching about 25 years, I believe. Somewhat in through there.
I didn't realize it was the same because this is, I think, year 25 for Tori.
Yeah. I'm pretty coaching. Sure it is for Joe because he was out for 18 years working with parole and corrections, so that would make it just about right.
Okay.
Might be close to 28, but somewhere around that area.
But still, I mean, that's a majority of your life. I mean, not a majority, but...
a lot of your life.
It is. And the thing, here's what people want to know. So, like, how much time, other than the weekends, because even the weekends can be busy for coaches. But if you were to take a guess, how much time do you guys would spend together in a year?
Well, they're mostly home by what? 6:37 at night, other than the weekends. And so.
And not on and game days.
And game days. Mm-hmm. You know, so. What? That's.
Of course, timing. We have football, basketball.
Yes.
All of
all of that. So.
Sports.
Yeah, that's the beauty about living in a small town.
I'll say this. There was a time, not now, but there was a time in the past when Tori was teaching dual credit. He was coaching, teaching, and we saw him one night a week, with the exception of Sunday. The rest of the week, we saw him one night a week. And so we were having to, he was gone before the kids got up from school, and he usually got home after they'd gone to bed because this was when they were younger. So there is a lot of time committed to coaching responsibilities.
A lot more than people realize, I think, sometimes.
And yeah, and that's why, you know, we wanted to ask because, like small schools, the coach has to do everything almost. You know, other like you said, you know, we got football, we got basketball, you have track, golf. I think
cross-country.
Golf is, cross-country, tennis. And yeah, you know, your hands are full, and even in the summertime, I mean, you guys, I mean, it's nice, but still, they're working in a way, aren't they?
There's about a 6-week window there.
It's usually about the first, 4 or 5 weeks after school's out that you might have free. That just depends on if you've got other things, you know, planned or things like. They've got things that they still have to take care of at school with the sports things. They've got to store everything. They've got to wash everything before they store it, clean up everything. And it's just like with ball games. When everybody else gets to go home at the end of the ball game, they're still, an hour and a half maybe?
Mm-hmm. Always the last ones out.
Yeah. And, you know, lots of times I'm already asleep when Joe gets home.
So, you know, coaching your own kid, what do you see your husband? How do you see the, like, how do they act, you know, towards?
Which one, the coach or the?
Both. Let's do both, okay? We'll do the coach and then you can do the child, okay? Or if you want to do the child first, then the coach. Because, you know, that's one of those things I really wanted to know is, like, do they discuss this at home? Do you sit together? Because I know, like, brothers, when we were on the team, you know, people were like, y'all probably talk football all the time. We're like, not really.
But. Well, we have one daughter, and the time that she was in school, Joe was in probation and parole. So I only saw him coach her like in peewee things in the evenings. And she was just like any other kid. He treated her just like anybody else, just like he coaches anyone else.
I think maybe our experience is probably a little bit different because when both girls were in school, Tori was coaching. Of course, Cherish was athletic trainer. She was more focused from that point of view. But Destiny, she participated in a few things she had no desire to participate in.
No pressure there, was
it? Especially when it has to do with points, you know, like district, you know, track and those kinds of things. But there's a lot of analyzing that goes on, a lot of reviewing. This could be done differently, you know, a lot of conversations that I sit back and listen. You know, it's fun to me to hear the interactions. You know, Destiny's gone on. She has coached some volleyball. Mm-hmm. She loves coaching. You know, so we have those kinds of things that goes on. Like I said, a lot of analyzing, a lot of reviewing. We'll go home, and there's times when they'll watch the entire game after we've just played the game. They go back and watch the entire thing again. But yeah. There is a love and a passion for it, you know, and of course our kids can't help it because they've grown up in it. Mm-hmm. That's all they've ever known.
Well, it's just like any career. I think it's a calling. And if it's just like teaching, working with kids in anything. If you don't feel called to do what you're doing, then it's not going to be fun. Mm-hmm. And if you're not having fun, sometimes it's really, really difficult. But enjoying watching them succeed, enjoying watching them maybe reach some kid that somebody else hasn't, but they can through athletics, it's a pleasing thing to know.
It really is, because just like you said, you know, you reach a child or a kid, you know, there's that teacher, and for me, you know, everybody think, well, which athletic coach? No, believe it or not, he was a band teacher I really enjoyed. You know, just he had confidence in me that I could play an instrument. Of course, I didn't think I could. I tried to let me play drums. I said, let me play drums. Nope. And then one day they saw us in a talent show, and they go, I guess you weren't lying. They're like, duh. mine had nothing to do with athletics. Now, Grant, I had some good coaches, yes.
But you had a connection.
Yes.
And I think that's what she's talking about. The awesome thing, you know, having them being coaches for 25 years and involved in the school system and also being at different locations, there's thousands of students and athletes that they've been able to have an impact with, and to have a former student send a college graduation or a wedding invitation, those are amazing moments to recognize that there was an impact there that was positive. To get those phone calls when they're in college, hey coach, I need help, you know,
right?
And those are so much fun, even for me, you know. It's a huge blessing for when those things happen. And it does happen, and it happens frequently, and it makes it very much worth it for us sharing, if that makes sense, because while they're not our children,
but they
you
are.
Know, we, and I say we because, yes, I'm Mrs. Coach Pete, and we're the wives, but it's an extended family, very much so, and we may not have the same interaction, and we may not be there all the time, but we are very much affected by them and care just as much about them because they come home and share their concerns, share the things that are going on. And so we're just as involved. It just doesn't look the same.
I would have to agree. There's one coach in Panhandle that's still around, and I still call him coach. You know, it's like, hey, I'm Steve. No, you're not. You're coach. To me, you will always be coach. You know, I don't care if I'm 80 years old and you're 105, you're still coach. Mm-hmm. You know, and he was another one that had a big impact on me. But after this, I'll tell you a funny story about him. Don't want to put it over the air, but
I think even though our husbands are coaches, the kids sometimes think that we are too. You know, because they come up, will they say things to you or about a game or mm-hmm. expect? And I think it's a part because they see us as a unit, as a pair, or at least I hope they do.
No, you're right. No, you're right.
I don't always understand what they're asking me though, because mm-hmm. it's a different perspective, and their memories that they have concerning games and certain plays. I'm like, honey, I believe you. You know, I'm. Yeah. I know that it happened, but I would have to see it again. But they remember those details, and it has a huge impact on them that the coaches care, remember, and that it means something. You know, it's significant because they may walk away and not ever play sports again. But these times are important, and who they are, not just on the field, but who they are as people, it matters. Yeah. It matters who they're becoming as growing up and becoming adults, you know, to be people who have jobs and parents themselves. And so it's not just about the sports.
I agree. Like I said, yeah, there's those moments with a particular coach. I told a story here not too long ago about me and White Deer and a coach where a play went the other way and these guys got quite a few yards. And the first guy off the field after he called a timeout was, yeah, that's right, it was me. So guess who got the butt chewing? Me. But it went the other way around. Saturday morning, we're watching the film. Here comes that play. Coach just turned around and said, sorry, Roach. It's okay. You know, and that's something I'll always remember. You know, yeah, I got chewed out, but I was like, I wasn't going to say a word. No, it wasn't me. No. So I just.
My dad used to always tell me, though, if I got a chewing out mistakenly, I'm sure he missed one somewhere down the line mm-hmm. that I needed to have. And that's, we're human. We make mistakes.
Yeah.
But we generally catch them and make them right.
Well, ladies, I do appreciate you guys filling in for your husbands.
And welcome back. Groom Tiger Football, where we've got the district contest here, and they jump straight to zero. So we're about to have the kickoff from the Tigers down to Silverton. Silverton winning the toss and elected to receive.
Yeah, Cooper Treadwell will be getting ready to do the kicking.
I don't know if we got headlights on at the end of the stadium, so yeah. It's going to be a little bit of time. So anyway, we'll go back to what we were talking about earlier. This is going to be what is effectively seems to be the district championship matchup between these two teams. Whoever wins tonight is likely going to lead the district into the postseason. And currently they're both 1-0. Tigers defeating Derisette last week, and I believe Silverton defeated LaForge. Wasn't that correct?
Yes, they did.
All right, we got the headlights off. So coming back, getting ready for this kick to start the game.
And here we go.
And it's going to be an onside over to the left side. It's picked up quickly. And that's number 15 for Silverton. He keeps on his feet all the way down to the 30-yard line of the Tigers. Number 15, that's Zayden Ortiz. And I'll try and pick up on these names as quick as I can. That was one I wasn't expecting to pick the ball at.
Yeah.
So they'll have first and 15. They got all the way down to the Tigers' 29-yard line on that return. And they'll start their series of the game at that point.
And this morning, during the quarterback club, one of the big things Coach Pete was mentioning was, of course, you know, you got to know where number 16 is, and we see him, he's back deep.
Silverton to the line, a strong right set, a slot to left and motion back to the left. There's a pitch back to Francis. He's off to the right side. Oh, he's got all kinds of room on the outside, and he's got the edge going all the way in for a first play touchdown for Silverton from the 29 yards out is Sawyer Francis, number 16. Senior.
And that's what he does. And the two guys that went to tackle him, they went low. That was something that Coach Pete mentioned. He goes, don't go low on him because
went low and then they sealed that right side.
And he was gone.
On for the point after attempt, number 13. That's Jace Alvarado. Be doing the kicking duties. There's a snap. The hold is down. The kick is up. Plenty of leg behind it. It hits the upright and goes in. That's going to be a successful PAT. So with 9:45 left in this first quarter, 15 seconds rolled off. Silverton strikes quick and leads 8-0, and we'll take a break and be back with you at the kick.
You can trust Mike's Pharmacy on Highway 287 in Clarendon to fill your doctor's prescriptions accurately and quickly. With owner Mark Land and pharmacist Brandon Frausto, walk in, drive through, or request local delivery. A pharmacy filled with over-the-counter medications, medical supplies, and a staff that's totally dedicated to you. Call 874-3554, Mike's Pharmacy in Clarendon. With owner Mark Land and pharmacist Brandon Frausto, a real commitment of excellence to you and your family.
All right, getting back to the game. The Silverton Owls struck quick. One play, 29 yards, and Sawyer Francis scored.
So coming out to do the kicking for the Silverton Owls, that's number 13, Jace Alvarado. He also does the PAT kicking for him, point after attempts, and he'll be booting the ball deep.
Yeah, back deep for the Tigers would be number 10, Cooper Treadwell, sophomore.
I say it's going to be deep. You never can tell. Lots of times it's going to be onside. But
this one kind of looks like he's –
yeah, he's setting up to kick it off to the right.
And everybody's moving over to the left.
So we're set up to kick. there is an onside over to the right side.
Oh, nice. That was a nice kick, though. But good job. And number five, Bryson Shuck with the recovery. And the Tigers will take over. First and 15. Ball is about the 33-yard line.
That kick took the perfect bounce. It just did. What you want on an onside kick.
And I can't remember who it was. Somebody looked like he was kind of a little bit offsides, but they didn't call it. So we're not, you know, the refs didn't see it. And here in a little bit, we'll introduce the refs. We haven't got the refs'
names. Yeah, we got the refs' names tonight.
So Tigers going to come up. They're going to be in a strong right. Pete looking over. Back deep will be Treadwell. Pete's under center, takes a snap, drops back. He's looking to throw, pitches it over to Treadwell. Treadwell now throws it over number two, Trayson Corley, and he heard footsteps, and that's why he dropped the ball.
That's number two, the Carlos Alanis that was stomping up on that play. He had it read from the beginning. That's an interesting double throw that we haven't seen the Tigers do before.
Well, you know, Coach Pete's always every week. You know, he throws in that little one play that we don't know about.
The defense on that, lots of pressure coming off the line.
Yeah.
Made that play develop, I think, a little quicker than they wanted it to.
So it's second and 15. Again, Tigers going to come up in a strong right.
Strong left.
Strong left, that's right, yep. And Pete's under center. Takes it, he's dropping back, and he's looking to throw, and he pitches it over again to Treadwell. And this time Treadwell's got a block by Shuck, and he's doing it down to the sidelines. And he's going to get knocked out of bounds. The ref is going to say right at about the 31-yard line, and that's going to be enough, or it's going to be pretty close. Let's see.
Yep,
they say it's a first down for the Tigers.
Let's see, it was right there at it. That was number two, Alanis, and number 13, or number 15, Ortiz, that were in on the tackle.
So that's kind of like the same play, except he just didn't throw it.
Well-designed play.
Yeah, nice block by Shuck. So, again, this time Tigers are going to come up to the line of scrimmage. It's going to be in a little tight spread this time. Pete's in the middle. He's got Treadwell, and I believe Corley. It's a quick handoff over to Cooper and a nice little back handoff, and there's Cooper running down the field. Finally going to get brought down at, looks like the 21?
Yep,
right about the 21-yard line. So it's going to be a second and about six for the Tigers. It's a nice little play.
Yeah, Alanis ran him down from behind and got hold of the jersey to slow him down, and that's why they were able to get the stop.
Yep, again, Tigers come up in that tight spread again. Pete getting ready to take the snap. Snap, a little handoff to Corley this time. Corley cuts it up the middle, and he's still on his feet. Finally going to get brought down, maybe about 3 yards on that play. Nice job by the Owls.
That was Sawyer Francis in on the tackle there, but they're getting awfully close to that first down marker.
Yep. So it's a third and a short 2-4 the Tigers.
This is nice to see the Tigers getting some, some nice down and distance on each play.
I'm sure there's a pass in here somewhere. Designed him that. So, again, now this time it's a strong right. Treadwell take the snap, and he handed off to Pete, and Pete's going to be
really
close. Yeah.
Nope, they're going to mark him up.
Oh, let's see.
Yep,
first down. Wow. Nice job by the Owls, but even better job by Repeat to get the first down.
Yeah, just stuck his head in there far enough to get that yard, and I didn't see who it was in the middle that made the stop.
I didn't either, but I just – someone got a nice shot of Stephen Keeler telling Pete what to do. Duck your head and go for it. So here we go. Another little tight diamond spread this time. Treadwell's getting ready to take the snap. It's a high snap. He pitches it back to Pete.
That's
we got flags.
That's motion.
Yeah, that's on us.
I think it's on the center even. He kind of fell over the front of the ball before he snapped it.
Yep. Back up five here. Get the official call from the ref.
He's struggling to get the. Yep.
Yeah, false start. That's all right. He'll get it figured out here in a little bit.
Yeah, something came off the top of it, it looks like.
So that's gonna back him up. Well, I think now his mic is on.
Now his mic is on.
He'll get it figured out. There we go. So it's going to back him up five. It's going to be first and 20 for the Tigers. The ball is at the.
He's still on.
Yep. That was loud.
Yeah, I think he figured it out. There you got a shot off.
Another high snap again. This time, Pete, he is looking for number 24. There's Weinheimer.
What coverage there.
Perfectly timed there by
The pass was just a little bit slow, but Ortiz managed to come all the way over from his safety position to close the distance on that and got a hand on the ball.
Yep, and it was a good throw, too, because, I mean.
He was open for a long time in there. It was just a little bit delayed. Right, yeah, he's still on.
Yeah, so it's a second and 20 for the Tigers.
Ball. Man, what a nice pass.
It was a pretty pass. Tigers, this time, they're going to come up in a spread. They got trips over to the left. Snap to
once again, a
Treadwell.
High snap.
Yep, there's Pete. He's got some running room, and he's going to go and gets knocked out of bounds. Maybe he got 6 yards on that play. It's going to bring about a third and 14, maybe.
Looks like the original line of scrimmage. That's all Anissa that chased him out of bounds and made the stop. There was good coverage downfield. Really, yep. Nothing opened up for him to make the throw.
And I'm glad he didn't force the throw either.
Yeah.
So, like Tim said, back to the original line of scrimmage. This time it's a third and 15. Got 7:39 left in this game. Owls are up 8-0. Tigers come up. This time in a spread. We got Twins over to the right, one left. Court is getting ready. He takes a snap. Oh. High snap again. Back to Pete. Pete running over to his right.
Uh-oh.
And he gets rid of it. And there's Corley. He's got the ball. He was trying to get out of a tackle. Maybe we got a flag too, so we'll see what the flag.
Late.
Yeah, it did. So we'll see what happened.
I think it might have been blocking in the back by the Tigers.
Personal foul, face mask. Ooh. 16 defense.
I was wrong on that one.
Half to the goal line. Automatic first down.
Yep.
That was on the tackle, I guess, because Sawyer was in there on that tackle.
And we'll mention Sawyer Francis has some relatives here in Groom, Miss Amy Fields and Matt Fields. So I bet they're not here. I bet they're in the comfort of their home watching this game. So Matt, Amy, I'm glad you're getting to enjoy it. So it's first and goal for the Tigers. Ball is at about the 8 yard line. It's a tight spread again. Handoff to Treadwell. He comes around the left side, and did he get in? And he got in for a touchdown. Nice little kind of behind the back, who's got the ball, and
frees up a lot of blockers for the Tigers too, because there's a lot better blocking than we've seen on the outsides for them.
Yep. 7-17. Tigers are now 6, the Owls 8, and number 10 Cooper Treadwell getting ready to kick the Brumley Insurance extra point. And I forgot to mention that was a wood flying touchdown too.
Yeah, I saw it on the screen. Yep.
Snap, hold, kick. That one is good. So we got a tie ball game, 7:17 left. We're going to take us a quick timeout. You're watching Groom Tiger Football, SixManiaSports.com.
From the farm to the ranch and from crop hail to family friendly, Brumley Insurance in downtown Groom covers it all and have been for over 42 years. Your full service agency has you covered, representing some of the top companies in America, including Germania to Pro Ag. See Kim Brumley Ritter for more information on safety and security for whatever you're covering. Locally owned, locally operated at 93 Broadway in downtown Groom. That's Brumley Insurance.
All right, we're back, Groom Tiger Football. We also got to thank we are on 99.3 KEFH, or Mr. Joe Davis. Thanks for letting us hijack the radio for the evening. The towers. And we got something we're going to introduce. We got the referees, and they were very nice to give us a card and everything. So the white hat, Mr. Kerry Haney, umpires Nathan Flores, line judge Dylan Kazar, head linesman Zach Altman, and the back judge Larry Fulton. Thank you guys for doing what y'all do. So Treadwell getting ready to kick, and it's another little squib kick. Bounces over and wisely, the Owls were smart, let it go out of bounds.
A little bit firm, went out of bounds, so they'll move it, 5 yards forward from there?
Yep.
So they'll be close to midfield. It looks like they'll probably end up around the 39 or so. Ball went out at the 34.
There we get the formal explanation from the hit of the ref.
Free kick out of bounds by the kicking team. 5 yard penalty from the dead ball spot. First down.
No, we want to go our way.
Yeah. Oh, it's fine if you want to go backwards. We're not going to say anything.
Yeah, so they're saying it went out at the 35, just inside midfield. And that's where the Silverton Owls will start this series. They're in a spread formation this time. They got two to the right.
Kenny
Francis is the deep back, or Sawyer. Yeah, Francis is the deep back. There's a snap to Alanis, and he puts it on the ground. He cannot break the line of scrimmage. He throws to Francis. What a catch.
We're going to have a block
spinning
in the back.
Around backwards.
Yeah, we're going to have a block in the back. Treadwell, he was rushing, and they hit him in the back, so this one's going to go backwards a little bit. But
yeah, very short gain. I think they only had two on the play. They're having a little discussion on the far side, but we'll get the official.
Illegal block in the back, 13 on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Replay first down.
So from the spot of the foul, so that was behind the line of scrimmage. Mm-hmm. Looks like about 6 yards behind the line, so that's going to end up being a 16-yard penalty, all told. So we all know what that means. That's going to bring up first down and officially a country mile at 31 yards.
There you go, Matt Fields.
Yeah, we've got it.
We got it early.
So up to the line again, strong right set. There's motion towards the left. Alanis takes it, pitches it back to Francis. Francis up the middle. He breaks a tackle. He's still on his feet. Breaks another tackle. And he's still going. He's finally tripped up at the 27-yard line. What a huge gain on that as he went all the way from their 25 to the 30 of the Tigers.
Yeah, McGinty was finally the one that finally got to bring him down. And kind of looked like last year. You know, when they had Cooper Cox, and that was just a beast. To try to bring down.
And they moved the ball up a little bit. It's actually at the 24-yard or the 29-yard line of the Tigers, and they'll have second down and four.
And, you know, and they had a chance. They had him tackled. I mean, they had him in the back.
They had him several times. So but, short spread here for the Owls up on this second down play. There's a snap to Francis. He pitches back to Alanis. Alanis breaks up the middle and is wrapped up. Gets about a yard on the play.
Yeah. Kenny had him held, and Noah came in and gave him the final – punch, not a punch, but I mean the nice little hit.
Yeah, so that'll bring up third down. They did get one on the play. Be third down and a little over, right at about three, a little over two. This ball's sitting around the 27-yard line of the Tigers for this third down play. Clock continues to run. We have 5:55 left in this first quarter of play, and we've got a tie game so far, 8-8. Silverton scores on their first play. Groom puts together a good drive to score. Up to the line, strong right set, slot left, snapped all in east, pitched back to Francis, and he runs directly up the
right
middle.
He's
finally
tripped
up, but he's got enough for the first down.
Yeah, but brought down by Noah Wood and Bryson Shuck, but like you said, that was enough for first.
It's down to the 22-yard line of the Tigers. They'll have first and 15. As Silverton is putting together a drive on this one, and so far has been doing it strictly on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
We'd like to remind everybody that we are Sixmania, sixmania.com. You can go to our website. We're at sixmansports.com. You can go in there, see our back archives, a lot of other pictures and stuff. Coming up to the line now is Silverton. They're in a spread formation. Alanis takes a snap back to Francis. He's running up the middle. There's nobody near him. He's off to the right side.
And
puts a move on the Tiger out there and goes in for another touchdown to the exact same spot.
He put a move on Noah Wood right there at the end. And, again, just what Coach Pete had mentioned at the first, do not go low on him.
Yeah.
And there you go. You know, and but you know what? A very talented running back. He's a one heck of an athlete.
So on for the extra point attempt. Is number 13, Alvarado. Hold is good. The kick is up. Got the foot, but he goes off to the right, so it's unsuccessful. That's going to leave the score 14-8. 4:55 left in this first quarter of play. Silverton Owls leading. We'll be back with you after this.
Enjoy the best of both worlds under that red awning on the highway in Memphis when you stop and shop and eat at the Cottage. The Cottage in Memphis. And along with a variety of ladies' fashions, jewelry, bed and bath choices, and home decor, top off your stop with something good to eat with the Cottage's full menu. Tasty desserts, teas, frappuccinos to cappuccinos. CDB oils are also available at the Cottage in Memphis. Look for that red awning. They're on the highway, 287, and come on in and enjoy the Cottage in Memphis.
Go ahead. I'm sorry, Tim.
I was going to say we're back with you, Groom Tiger Football, and the Silverton Owls have just put another score on the board and now lead 14-8. And I got corrected by Junebug. It is sixmaniasports.com, not sixmansports. If you go there, I'm not sure exactly what you'll find, but it may not be nice. So sixmaniasports.com. And at 4:55 left in this first quarter of play, we'll be awaiting the kick here from Silverton to lead Groom into their second series. Number 13, Alvarado kicking. He's going to boot it deep this time.
Yeah. Back Treadwell, he's going to let it go back. Yeah,
That was a little brave.
Yeah, I thought for a second it's like here it's going to stop right at the one.
Thanks for that, Junebug. I do appreciate the support that I get from you.
Oh, we got to tell you what, you know, guys, folks, you know, we love our guys because if it's not for them, Tim and I, we're just two guys in a silly costume talking.
Yeah, just talking heads. That's all. That's all I do is just show up.
So it's 1st and 15 for the Tigers. The ball will be at the 20-yard line. Tigers are going to come up to the line of scrimmage again. They're going to be in that tight spread. We got Noah and Ryan each of us. Handoff. Pete is the one who got the ball.
Oh, and it's a fumble.
Yep.
And it's recovered. There is a flag down, though. We'll see what happens there.
That was just messed up.
I know, I couldn't tell if they missed the backwards handoff.
I think that's what was happening. He was trying to get it back to him, and he was on the wrong side. But we'll see what the refs have to see.
If this was holding on defensive holding, which it looked like it was out kind of where there were some receivers in the area, then it might make it a moot point.
Yeah. And while we're waiting for that, we're going to say some thanks to some of our sponsors. One of them, Panhandle Wind. You know, those guys really, really helped us out big time. So we're watching the replay, and it's going to be on us.
It looked like it was on a low block.
Yep,
and going out into the flat.
And they're going to wind up getting the ball anyway after that.
Yep.
And again, thank you guys, you know, for the replays, you know. A lot of people don't realize that, and they really love the broadcast.
There's no foul on the play. The result of the play is a turnover, Silverton's ball.
Okay.
All right. So, yep. First and goal.
Costly mistake by the Tigers there, turning that ball over deep in their own territory. First and goal on the 10. And Silverton's going to come up to the line. They're going to be in that. Well, they got a strong right set, but they got a wide receiver far out to the right. So everybody's on the right side of the ball this time. Alanis is the up back. Francis is going to be the deep back. There's motion off the right side. Alanis gets it, hands it off to Francis. Will pitch his back. He goes up the middle, and he's going to get 4 on the play.
Yeah, kind of brought down. That was number 3, Noah Wood. But still a nice little run by Sawyer.
Yeah, cut his legs out from under him. There wasn't a whole lot of space to run in there.
But, you know, Tigers did a good job there.
So that's going to bring up 2nd down as the ball is marked at the 6-yard line. 2nd down and goal. Tigers desperately need a stand here to offset that fumble. Silverton trying to take advantage of a faux pas by the Tigers. Strong right set, wide receiver to the left. It's number 13, Alvarado. He's in motion coming in. Snapped all in east. He pitched to Alvarado as he's going over the right side. Cuts back into the middle of the field, goes in, and I'm not sure he was touched, but
I don't think he was.
Made some nice moves there to get in for another Silverton Owl touchdown. And you can check it out on the replay here. It's a nice run to change direction.
Nice kick out block by Sawyer, and gave him that little hole to run in for the score.
So Alvarado, responsible for that touchdown, is going to be doing the point after touchdown kick. He's 1-1 tonight so far. Hold is good. The kick is blocked by the Tigers, so unsuccessful again. 3:58 left in the first quarter. Silverton Owls leading 20-8, and we will be back with you after this.
Locally owned, locally operated, and ready to serve. That's Panhandle Drug in downtown Panhandle, Texas. And they're your full-service pharmacy, standing tall at the corner of Main and Highway 207. They're open every day but Sunday. That's Monday through Fridays, 9 to 6, and 9 to noon on Saturday. And along with a variety of healthcare products, you can top off your next visit to Panhandle Drug with a stop for a malt or a shake in their old-fashioned soda fountain. That's Panhandle Drug, downtown Panhandle. Mark Land, owner and pharmacist.
All right, we're back. Groom Tiger football district matchup. This one's probably going to decide between one and two. And kind of a little, some remnants of last year.
Yeah, last year's game was an epic battle all the way down to the end.
You know, we got down by two touchdowns, and then we came back. But like I said, that was one of the best games ever, I'll have to admit.
So on to kick for Silverton is Alvarado, number 13. It's going to be booted down. It's going to skip.
And Treadwell picks it up, coming over to his right, following a block, and he's going to get met by, I believe it was that Alanis.
I believe so, number two.
Yep. That was him on the tackle. So the Tigers will take first and 15. Ball will be at the 24-yard line.
Yeah, nice 9-yard return by Treadwell to pick that up and get a little positive yardage out of it.
Yep. Also, I'm going to give a shout-out to Mr. Nate Rowland. He is the man of sixmanfan.com. Check him out there on Facebook. And a lot of great pictures. He does a lot of good things for six-man football. So thanks, Nate. So they bring it over to the right hash. Tigers are getting ready. It's a first and 15. And they're on a strong left. Pete's under center. Kind of looking around. Snap quick handoff to Corley, but the Owls were not fooled on that play.
Yeah, Alvarado read that one from the get-go, had hold of him, I think, before the handoff even completed. It looked like Pete was trying to pull it even.
Mm-hmm. But he got 2 yards on it. I thought he made it back to the line of scrimmage, but it's a 2-yard gain.
Yeah, those quick hitters are hard to not get something out of.
So I'll bring up second and 13 for the Tigers. 3:24, clock still rolling. And some Tigers are going to line up. Strong left within a spread. Treadwell takes the snap, pitches it back to Pete. Pete looking for the throw. And he's got number two. Yep. He had number two.
He missed him.
Yeah, he had Corley open, but then again.
That was number 15.
He had good closing speed.
Yes, Ortiz got in there. Alanis was behind him, and Ortiz made a jump on the ball. Ball was behind him and actually went in and out of Ortiz's hands.
So nice little closing speed by him. So that's going to bring up a third and 13 for the Tigers. Clock stops after the incomplete. Tigers come up in this time it's just a tight spread, but snap back to Pete, and Pete has to throw it, and he's got number three. Noah Wood wide open,
and just
went over his head, and there was nobody in front of Noah.
Alanis was the closest one, and he didn't pick him up. He was about 4 yards behind him.
Yeah, that was probably going to go for six.
But a world of pressure on Pete back there from the two rushers from Silverton with Francis on one side and number four, Mullins on the other, both coming in hard.
So it's fourth and 13, and like we said, if you know Coach Pete, we don't punt. A snap. Pete's going to throw him. There he is. He's looking for number three, Noah Wood. Again, kind of over his head. How do you overthrow Noah and Ryan? I still don't know how we do that.
It's number 13, Alvarado, in coverage. He was there as the ball got there, made contact, and I think assisted in that ball being dropped.
Yeah.
So that will be a turnover on downs, and once again, Silverton will be starting deep in the Tigers' territory. They're going to be at the 26-yard line with first and 15. 3:02 left in this first quarter of play, and Silverton leading 20-8. Kind of got a short spread here from the Owls. Alanis takes it, pitches back to Francis. Francis going over the right side, and he gets 4 on the play, I believe, maybe 3.
Yeah, nice little bit better blocking, or better tackling, I should say, by the Tigers that time.
Yeah, they're closing that middle. That's where he's been kind of running free.
Yeah, that was Noah Wood there on the stop. Noah and Kenny. I believe it was Noah and Kenny there on the stop.
So they are going to get 3 on the play. It bring up second down and 12 as the ball sitting just inside the 24-yard line of the Tigers. And so far, Silverton's had all their success on the ground. Mm-hmm. They've only attempted one pass play, I think, haven't they?
Yes.
Coming to the line in a strong right set. They got their slot to the left in Alvarado. Alanis takes it, pitches it. Well, no, he doesn't. He keeps it. He's going to have to throw this ball. He's got a receiver downfield, and he hits him in stride. And that's number 4, Mullins. And it's going to be really close the first day. Actually, they're going to mark him enough. It's going to be at the 10.
Yeah, first to go. That was very nice. That was a very nice throwing pass by Alanis.
He had two receivers out there. One was a bit deeper, but a little more covered. Mullins was wide open over the middle.
Thanks to our replay crew, I hope the coaches saw what I saw, because something's going to happen, because Francis was left all alone.
Yeah.
There was nobody.
Yeah, he
everybody
went
came
off to
this
the right.
Way. Yeah.
Yes.
And so everybody came this way.
First down and goal. Strong right, slot left. Motion by Alvarado to the right. Alanis takes his pitch back to Francis, and he's going to go. Picks up a nice block as he waited for it to develop in front of him. Goes in for another touchdown on the right side of the end zone.
Yeah, just really good block and opened up that hole for Francis to go
in.
Easy. In
the replay, you can see the Tiger standing there, and then Alanis got in there, got a helmet on him, moved him out of the way.
That's all you need.
Alvarado on to kick the extra point. Extra points. Hold is good. Kick is up. Lots of distance this time. Right through the middle and good. Add two more to the total. 2:06 left in the first quarter. Silverton has jumped out to a 28-8 lead in this contest, this district contest, and we will be back with you for the kickoff after this.
The H.J. Garrison Oil Company is a regional supplier of quality gas and diesel to convenience stores, service stations, to the oil fields, to farms and ranches as well. You can also pull into a Garrison's near you and fill up at one of their many convenience stores, from Perryton to Plainview, Memphis to McLean, Wichita Falls to Clarendon, Groome, Childress, and two locations in Shamrock. At the H.J. Garrison Oil Company and Garrison's convenience stores, they deliver. For more information, see H.J. Garrison at hjgarrison.com. That's hjgarrison.com. And for job opportunities, too.
And we're back with you, Groom Tiger Football. The Silverton Owls have just put another score on the board and lead 28-8 with 2:06 left in this first quarter of play.
I did forget to mention during our pregame, which was sponsored by Pennell Pharmacy, Mr. Mark Land and the rest of the gang, go by and go see him for all your, I can say this today, pharmaceutical needs. There, I had one day, I could not say pharmaceutical to save my life.
I don't even want to know what you were saying, but.
it was nothing close to that.
Alvarado on to kick, and he's going to boot it over to the side. It's a floater that's caught in the air.
Oh, yeah, caught by Pete, and.
He got about 2 yards on the return. That was a quick stop.
Yep, good job by the Owls, and Tigers will take over first and 15. And the ball will be at the 30.
We're going to give them a little more yards
on it.
They
did give them a little bit more yards, yeah. So it's going to be a first and 15 at the 34, at their own 34. And Tigers need a score. If you want to kind of stay with them, you can't let these guys get too far ahead.
Yeah, you're going to have to close the gap.
So Tigers come up in a tight spread. Snap to Pete. Hands it back to Corley this time. He comes around the right side, but good job by the Owls to get him shut down.
And the ball actually came out, but he was already down.
And back to the original line of scrimmage. No gain on the play.
I was watching the Owls on that play, and they have changed the way that they're rushing the line. They're making they've already made an adaptation to that backwards handoff. They're not falling into the gap of getting too deep and being able to be kicked out.
Yeah, because they're running a 2-3-1 defense right there. So, again, Tigers come up again in a tight spread. Pete getting ready to take the snap. Takes the snap. It's a quick handoff. Oh, it's a fake handoff over to Treadwell, but nice form tackle there on Shuck.
That's Saiz, number three, Saiz. Saiz?
Yeah, let's see what
it is. S-A-I-Z.
Saiz, I guess.
Saiz, he read that play all the way from the beginning. Wonderful tackle.
Yeah, nice form tackle. So it's third and long for the Tigers. Third and 14. Again, tight spread. Pete getting ready to take the snap. Takes the snap. It's a handoff or a fake handoff to Treadwell. And, boy, again.
Just read that play all the way through.
You know, Ryan, he was there, but, like, again.
At number 15, play. That's Ortiz that's made that play. He's making that play from the middle of the field. He's closing on whoever we have going deep. Mm-hmm. But I have noticed that typically we only have one person going deep.
Yeah.
So we haven't really pressured him in a way where he's got two to look at.
Tigers come out. This time they're going to be in a diamond spread. Snap back to Treadwell. Pitch to Pete. Pete's looking. He's going deep. He's looking for that as number five.
And the best punt ever except for as Alvarado's coming up. He's still got the ball. He's on his feet. He's still moving. He's going. He's looking around.
He's still on his
just
feet.
Breaking tackles and going
left
and going.
And, right, and finally gets
tackled at the six. I thought it was a great punt, but
yeah,
what a wonderful return.
Yeah, pushed forward another 5 yards after the
no flags.
Nope. So nice play by the Owls. You know, like you said, one of the best punts ever.
Yeah. Just missed tackle after missed tackle after missed tackle.
And Pete, he had to hurry. He was pressured. He had to hurry up and throw the ball. And just a little short.
Yep. Finally, he's wrapped up and brought down.
Now they're bringing it
during
back.
The return. Oh, we got a flag. Illegal block in the back on the return team.
Oh, the flag's right here on the sideline.
Spot of the foul. First down.
It's typical right in front of us, Tim, and we didn't see it.
Yeah. It's right where this bar goes across because I was looking around because I was wondering. I saw one of the Tigers jump up and he throws his hands in the air like he was, you know, something had happened, but. So I don't know. I wasn't paying attention on that in the run back, but
I was watching him. I was watching that nice little run back by him.
Still a heck of a return, but had he just batted it down, they'd have had better yardage. But so that's going to back it all the way up to the 34-yard line of the Owls, and that's where they'll start. 31.6 seconds left in the first quarter, and they'll have first and 15 for the Silverton Owls. And we're having a little discussion over on the sideline about the.
Yeah, I think Coach Hearn is wants a little bit more clarification.
Yeah, whenever the play was going, I noticed the Tiger throwing his arms up.
Yeah.
But I didn't think it looked like his head was in front of him. Yeah. But really good chance that Coach isn't going to win this battle.
Yeah.
Referee heading back out, so Silverton will be. We'll have 31 seconds left in this quarter.
Yeah, I said Coach Hearn wasn't happy with it, but, you know, it is what it is. Yeah, Coach Hearn, Coach Massey, those two guys, very, very classy guys. I've gotten to know them the last few years, and some really good guys.
Owls have twins to the right, a tackle to the right. Allen East takes it, pitches back to Francis. He's running straight up the middle. He does just what he's done every time. He breaks to the right. He's got the edge. He's just going to stretch this one out and go in for a touchdown on the right side. Took 9 seconds off the clock.
The thing that he is doing, very patient. You watch the blocks develop down the field, and he lets that happen. And then right there at the end, you know, he is a fast runner.
He just turns it on and goes in for another touchdown. Alvarado on to kick the point after. Snap is down. Hold is good. Kick is good once again. That's going to add two more. 22.6 seconds left in the first quarter, and the Silverton Owls extend their lead to 36-8. We will take a break and be back with you at the kickoff.
Before Old Man Winter comes knocking, start at your do-it-best hardware store, J&W Lumber Company, Highway 287 in Clarendon, with door and window insulation and caulking. All types of winter insulation products to keep you warm and lower your heating bills, along with everything in between for those winter projects. Hand tools to power tools, along with a complete line of paints and quality lumber. Your do-it-best hardware store can even help you with your wish list. Don't let Old Man Winter shut you down. Get prepared and plan ahead with your do-it-best hardware store, J&W Lumber Company, locally owned and operated on Highway 287 in Clarendon.
Hi, we're back. Friday night football at the TNT package. Tim and Tony back together again after a hiatus, but the Owls... Again, number 16, Sawyer Francis on the score, 36-8, 22.6 seconds left in this opening quarter. And the Tigers getting ready to
get the kick. Alvarado's coming on. He's doing the kicking. And he's going to boot it deep this time, way off to the right side.
And
it bounces. He was waiting on it, and he should have grabbed it and went.
Yep.
He thought it might go out of bounds. It did not.
And for those of you that are listening and care, we're getting to – we're kind of paying attention to the Panhandle Stratford score because those two teams undefeated in the district. Panhandle is up. Is that 9-0?
Yeah, it's 9-0. That was a minute ago. Actually, that was good a little bit ago. But with 51 seconds left in the first, Panhandle was up 9-0, a safety and a touchdown. So
yeah.
Not sure where they're at now, but let me see what I can dig up for you.
Yeah. And, you know, the only reason that I care about it, well, we both care about it. You know, we have relatives over there. I've got a nephew playing, and, of course, Tim and his family over there in Panhandle.
I don't necessarily like them, but.
I bet they're listening.
Oh, I know. Yeah. I know. My sister texted me.
So the Tigers are coming out. They're going to come out in the spread, and they've got Trips over to the right. Snap over to Treadwell. He pitches it back to Pete. And
Oh, man.
Yeah. He was ready to throw it and
just
brought it
crazy.
In.
Crazy.
Yeah, and Francis just laid him out.
Mullins, I believe, is the one that came across. He's been playing that left side, and he turned him back in, and Pete never saw it coming.
Nope. So, big loss. It is a second in the country mile.
But okay.
We hear the clock. We hear the horn, and it's a end of the first quarter.
Yeah, I'm showing Panhandle Panthers are up 9-7 at halftime.
Okay, so 36-8. We're going to take us our timeout. You are listening and watching Tiger football on sixmediasports.com.
The nonstop hits just keep on coming. Playing your favorite songs. Playing more of the songs you want to hear. The most hit music every hour.
I'm TNT. I'm dynamite. TNT. And I will. What do you want?
One great song always follows another. 99.3 KEFH, the station that's rocking Texas.
And we're back with you, Groom Tiger football, here for the second district football game. And right now the Silverton Owls are kind of schooling the Tigers 36-8 as we're starting the second quarter of play.
I think the only game that the Owls did not score was Jayton, because Jayton 45'd them. But
okay.
That's the only game. Tigers again in a little tight spread. Snap back to Pete, being rushed by Francis, and he gets rid of the ball.
And that's a safety.
Yeah, it is. And there goes the flag, and there's 2 points for Silverton.
Yeah, any time that you have that intentional grounding while you're in the grasp in the end zone, it's going to be a safety.
Yep. And there was
intentional grounding in the end zone. Result is a safety.
Yep. So that's going to give them two more. It's going to be 38-8 now with 9:54 left in the in this half, but also they get the ball.
Yeah,
so
they
Groom will have to punt to them or kick to them.
It's going to be interesting. I bet they use the tee. I don't know if they give a punt to them or not.
I would kick it off the tee and just kick it deep.
Too. Yep.
But
then while we're here, we're going to thank some of our sponsors.
Yeah, I was about to say, we got too much dead air here. We got to get something moving.
Yeah, we got to say thanks to 95 Irrigation for parts and service for your sprinklers and pivots. You know, be sure to give 95 Irrigation the call, and also S&D Spraying Service out of Panhandle. They can assist with your crops, pesticides, for all your agricultural needs. Give them a call, 806-537-5143. And say hi to Mr. Jason Davis, I believe.
Yeah, and we can't speak highly enough about our sponsors. It allows us to do a lot of things, bring this, and continue to expand the reach of six-man football.
Yes.
Just love the game and being able to bring it more in. That's with Six Mania, that's what we've done. Six channels every week between ours, and then we have five channels on What's the Mixler app. If you pull it up, search for Six Mania, then you can listen to some other games around the state.
Yeah. Also, we'll also try to help and put out, like I said, you know, we got Nate over here, Nate Rowland. He's now calling games for Knox City, and, you know, we try to put out when they're going to do it. So, yeah, this is one big thing. So it's a high kick.
And it's going to go out of bounds.
Another flag and another 5 yards.
So because it's inside the 30, they will put it at the 35-yard line because they move it up to the 30 and then give them the 5 for the out-of-bounds kick. Yeah, he gave it a name whenever they started. It was something free kick. I can't remember what he called it. Hmm. It sounded impressive. I'm not sure what it was. And Silverton's coming up to no ball on the field. They broke the huddle and ran up. There's not even a ball out there. So we'll give them a minute and see what happens.
Free kick out of bounds by the kicking team. 5-yard penalty from the dead ball spot. First down.
Oh, okay. Yeah, he's trying to move it the wrong way. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, I thought they just brought it to 30 and then moved it back, but guess not. Ball is going to be between the 33 and 34-yard line of the Owls. They're already up to the line.
Yeah, Tigers, their defense. Now it looks like they're going to do a little they got a 2-3 one also themselves. Yeah. It'll change on the
– Twins to the right, single leather to left. There's Alvarado moving in motion. He comes across, pitch back to Francis. He's got the middle. He's got the right side. Oh, he's gone. He's going up the right side again. He loves the right corner of that end zone, and he goes in for another touchdown.
Right up the middle.
Right up the middle, untouched.
Yeah.
And once he gets rolling, Tigers just kind of let him keep moving.
Yep.
So he charges in, score now 44-8, 9:47 left in this half, and they're on for the kick. That's going to be Alvarado trying to add two more to this total. There's a snap, the hold. It's good. The kick is good right up the middle. That's going to add two more. It's now 46-8, 9:47 left in this half of play. We'll take a break. Be back with you in a minute.
The Clarendon Outpost and Outpost Pharmacy is open and ready to serve their area customers, from food to fuel and pharmacy too, with the Outpost Pharmacy. Call for more details at 874-5201. That's locally at 874-5201. Or use their convenient drive-thrus on both sides of the building for food and pharmacy. Services and products are available at the Outpost, and they want to remind you to be safe and sound. Find the Clarendon Outpost at Outpost Pharmacy. Right there at the light in Clarendon. Look for the Phillips sign. Come on in.
So we're going to have to forgive us for the dead air. We, you know, have some little banter going back and forth, you know, we tell jokes to each other and some that are not appropriate for
the air.
Most of the listeners.
Yes, yes. But we try really hard.
Yeah, but we're, you know, we got to have fun while we do this.
Alvarado kicking off for the Owls after that touchdown. He's going to put it off on the ground this time. Side.
Yep, Corley Repeat gets the ball, and there it goes, Repeat. He's got one guy to beat, and that's Sawyer, and Sawyer brings him down.
And he gets tackled about the 24-yard line. And,
but a nice return, you know, finally something positive for the Tigers. It just we looked.
Yeah, Francis made a good tackle there in the open field as it just kind of opened up there in front of Pete. Mm-hmm. As everybody was kind of chasing that ball, I think they thought it was about to make it over to the sideline when he grabbed it.
Too. So it's a first and 15 for the Tigers. The ball will be sitting at the right about the 24-yard line. Tigers come up in a strong right. Pete's going to be under center. Treadwell back in the back. That's a quick pitch over to Cooper, and Cooper cuts it up. Nice little cut and a nice little run this time by Cooper. A gain of about 7 on that play.
Ortiz comes in from the safety position to close that down and does what safeties do best. He put his head in there and really, really put a lick on the running back to stop that play.
So we have second at about 8. The Tigers again come up to the line of scrimmage. We'll be in a strong, this time in a strong left. Pete be under center. Again, Treadwell back deep. Or not back deep, but the running back. Snap, pitch to Treadwell. Nice blocking by the Tigers, but the flags.
It's going to be a hold.
Yeah, I think on Noah. I believe he's going to get called for the infraction.
Right? Yeah, Alan East made the tackle over the side, and I think it was just for a very short gain. I don't think there was much made on that play.
So we'll get the official.
Holding. Yep. Offense number 24. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Still first down.
Ryan.
It was the other tall guy. His cousin, Ryan.
Down.
So that'll back the Tigers up 10, and it'll be second and after they mark it.
What, about 16 or so?
Yeah. Well, no, kind of go a little loss. It looks like it's going to be second and about 17.
It's a tweener.
Yeah, there we go.
It's an infinitesimal amount between 16 and 17.
Yeah. So, again, Tigers come up. They're going to be in a strong right. Pete, get ready to get under center. Takes a snap. It's a handoff.
Oh, he puts it on the ground. Oh, and he missed it. And Corley gets it back.
Yeah, wow. There was not a clean exchange whatsoever. But, yeah, luckily that the Tigers got it. So it's
Francis dove in there and just flat missed it, and then Corley rolled back over the top of him to make the recovery. And you can see on Francis's face right there, he is not happy with missing that.
Yeah. Yeah, you don't get those that very often.
But a short loss on the play.
Yep. So now it is third and about 20 this time. The ball is sitting right at the 30. Tigers, again, is going to be in a strong left. Pete will be under center. Takes a snap, and he tosses it over to Cooper, and Cooper gets corralled by Francis.
That was pretty obvious the way Cooper set up what was about to happen. Francis didn't even make a play on Pete. He went straight for Treadwell off to the left side.
He read it.
Because I was pointing at it because I couldn't figure out why Treadwell was so far to the right. So he sniffed that one out for another loss. The Tigers, having been sitting in pretty good position, now have a not quite a country mile.
Not yet.
But they're getting close.
Fourth and long. Fourth and very long.
Do the math. Come on, give me that panhandle math.
Not right away. Nope, it's not going to happen. Tigers are going to come up in a tight spread, direct snap back to Pete. He's got to throw it, and he's being pressured. And
just missed him.
Just missed it. And Francis gave him was the guy that gave him the pressure. He was looking for number two, Trace and Corley, but he would not have got very far either.
No, there's nice coverage right behind him. And I believe Mullins off on the other side is the one that kind of stopped him from being able to roll more to the right. So there's a turnover on downs. Ball sitting at the 34-yard line of the Owls. 7:49 left in this half of play, and the Owls have a commanding lead of 46-8, and the Tigers desperately need a stand to keep anything else from going up on this board. It's going to be a short spread for the Owls. Snapped Alanis. He fakes the handoff. He's got to throw the ball. He's got a receiver short.
Yep.
But he underthrew Mullins. Falls incomplete. Bring up second down.
Yeah. Nice job. Nice job by Cooper there on the pressure.
Yeah, he kind of bypassed everybody and was able to put pressure on him right away. So bring up second down and 15. So 7:45 left in this half of play. Silverton's got a second down play here, and they're coming up in a strong right, or in a – it's going to be a twins right with a slot to the right. Motion by Alvarado. Alanis takes it, pitches it to Alvarado. They scored on this play before, and he's rolling left and right. Oh, a missed tackle. Jumps over a guy. Now he's wrapped up. He misses another one. Misses another one,
and
he's going to go in. Only this time they're on the left side of the end zone instead of the right side, which is Francis's pick spot. And Silverton puts another score on the board now, 52-8, 7:32 left in this half of play. And it just looks like the wheels are falling off of the Tigers' defense.
Yeah. Looks like maybe he had some popcorn earlier in the game and he just wiped it on his shirt and along his pants because that's the way it just looked.
Because they're just sliding
bad.
Off. Yeah. Alvarado on to kick. High snap. Low kick. Off to the left. Unsuccessful. So score will stay at 52-8. 7:32 left in this half of play. And we will be back for the kickoff.
The Groom, McLean, and LaForest News is locally owned and operated. Local and state news that affect our communities. For only $37.50 for a year's subscription, 51 issues mailed to you, or you can have your subscriptions emailed to you. All major credit cards are accepted. Located in downtown Groom at 84th Broadway off of Old Route 66. Get your copy and see the latest news and best deals advertised in the area. The Groom, McLean, and LaForest News. Your news of record.
All right, we're back. Owls have jumped out to a commanding lead, 52 Tigers 8, and we still have 7 minutes and 32 seconds left.
We're chuckling because whenever Tony couldn't do his panhandle math, we had a little Pennsylvania math over there from Junebug.
Yeah.
So we actually knew what it was. We just decided to make him feel good about himself and let him put it up there.
Yeah, we just had to act like we didn't know what we're doing. Well, really, I mean, those that know me, it was not acting.
So it looks like they're going to change kickers this time. Alanis is setting up to kick. Alvarado stayed on the sideline. I guess he was tired after that run.
He did well-deserved break.
Yeah, he had to run the entire length of the field. Yeah. So Alanis will be kicking. He is going to put it on the ground.
And picked up number, that was number 3, Noah Wood there. Wisely jumps on it and falls in. It'll be a 1st and 15 for the Tigers. Ball is going to be at the 37-yard line, looks like.
Yeah, and this defense of Silverton has really stepped up. They had an opportunity. The Tigers had an opportunity on the last one. They had some good field position.
Yeah.
But they, Groom forgot to throw a ball out on the field. So we're waiting for a ball to come in to be marked off. But anyway, the Silverton defense playing a 2-3-1.
And doing a really good job.
Just killing the pass for the Tigers.
Yeah. So strong right. Snap back to Treadwell as a quick handoff to Pete. Runs up right up the middle. Kind of looks like Francis just right up the middle.
Yeah, just took off and went.
Yeah, I mean, nice quick handoff and run of about, let's see, we're going to call it 9. So bring up about 10. 2nd and 5 for the Tigers. A nice run by Grayson Pete.
I know Ortiz was in on it, so he just came off the side, too.
Again, Tigers in that same formation. Treadwell takes the snap. Another quick handoff, and look again, ducks his head right up the middle. I think he's got enough for first down.
And he's brought down by Francis on that one.
So
he's going to be real close. Yep, they're going to go ahead and give it to him.
Yeah, 1st and 15. And again, it's kind of surprising the Owls themselves.
just blowing up the middle. Yeah. They've changed. Usually Pete's running the quarterback position, and they switched it around a little bit and put Treadwell to just handing the ball off to see if they could get something up the middle of the field.
Yeah, now it looks like the Owls, they may be running a 4-2 now. Let's see if that's what they're going to line up.
Yeah, we'll see what they do when they line up. They've been faking that stunt in the middle and then backing up, and I'm wondering if they're going to go to 3-2-1.
Strong right. This time it's a fake handoff. And Treadwell's got a run being pressured by Francis, and he throws it, and he's looking for number 15.
Oh, what a catch. One-handed catch by Ortiz, and he's going and going and going. And
he's gone.
Yeah, what a block downfield by Francis. He trips a little bit, but he's still going to go in off on that right side. Another touchdown. It just was an underthrown ball.
Yeah.
And when he turned his back to the line of scrimmage, it's always hard to be able to turn around and pick up your receivers.
And I know, let's see, who was that? Somebody got pancaked by Francis, and they were looking for a flag, but nah.
It was a clean block, yeah. So coming on to kick will be Alvarado again. That was just an outstanding pick.
Yeah.
Hold is good. Kick is up. Kick is good. Add 2 more to that total. It's now 60. I thought it was 58 a minute ago.
It was 58, and then now the 2 points.
Now 60, okay. Yeah. 6:02 left in this half. Owls lead 60-8 on that pick and return by Ortiz. And like I say, that one-handed grab was just
– beautiful.
Just a great – he's played such really, really strong safety defense back there. It has just taken the pass game away from the Tigers.
And we're going to, thank some more of our sponsors. We've got to thank Boar Enterprises. Be sure you call Juanito and for all your tire needs and some minor repairs. I'll call Boar Enterprises. There he'll fix you up. Also, Jim West wants to wish the Tigers a great season. Jim and his partners, also known as Larry Mullen Curley. Say go Groom Tigers. That's an inside joke for those of you that know these guys.
Well, I'm hoping that the Tigers go ahead and get their head back in the game. It's not over yet.
No.
Still have an opportunity to take this thing the entire distance. Got to make some moves, make some changes. And, that's 2 scores off of turnovers. Those are tough. They've had a couple of turnovers on downs that have turned into scores. So it's just been some things that could have been corrected. But Tigers just need to get their head in there and get their head back in the game.
Yeah, it looks like the Owls had a couple of guys getting to come in to play. Getting ready for the kickoff.
So this is Alanis doing the kicking again. Alvarado's off on the sideline. Oh, it's going to be a little deep pooch.
Nice. There's Pete that got the ball and got about 2 yards after the catch. But, Tim and I, we point this out every year. these guys don't realize that they can put their hand in the air, call for a fair catch.
Yep. They don't have to attempt to catch. They can fair catch it and make sure that they get the ball wherever they're standing.
Just like a punt, you know, but again, you know, how many of these guys are gonna go back and listen to us and, you know, take our advice. So it's a 1st and 15 for the Tigers. Ball is at about the 27-yard line. Treadwell's getting ready to take the snap. Takes a snap. It's a quick handoff again to Pete, and he tries to go over to the left, but brought down by Francis. Yeah.
Well, on that one, Alvarado came up over the center and did not drop back. They actually closed the center of the field, so they're responding to what the Tigers are doing. And hopefully that might open something up over the middle for the passing game.
Yeah. We'll see. So back to the line of scrimmage, it kind of looks like. They're 2nd and 15 again for the Tigers. Again, they're in a strong right and back deep as Treadwell takes a snap. Quick handoff over to Pete.
Yeah.
A nice little block. Francis got brought down or got blocked, but nice closing speed by the rest of the Owls.
Yeah, they're all staying in the middle of the field. There was no gap in the middle of that time. They have done just what you said. They came up, started running 3-2-1, and they're just jamming that middle.
Yep. So it's 3rd and 2 on that, so let's call it 3rd and 13. This time Tigers are going to come up here and get in a strong right, and Pete's going to be under center this time. Takes a snap. It's a handoff over to Corley. It looks like it's going to be an option play, and there it is. And it's a bad pitch, and they're going to lose 3 yards on that, and it's going to be a 4th and long now.
Treadwell was fortunate that bounced into his hands.
Yeah. I mean, I saw it from up here, and I knew what it was
going
to be.
Yeah, I could see the option going because Corley actually started looking back before he started making the turn.
Yep.
4:44 left in this half, and Owls up 60-8. Tigers needing to close that gap a little bit to make it into the second half.
Tigers come up. It's a deep snap over to Treadwell to Pete, and he's got number 2. Oh. Corley, he was open.
Caught it on his knees, but
yep.
In behind him was number 15, Ortiz. So I'm not saying he wouldn't have got the first, but there was coverage there fairly close behind him. Turnover on downs is going to give the Owls the ball at the 28-yard line of the Tigers. 4:39 left in this half. And the Owls will have a 1st and 15.
Yep. Well, the Owls still have their
Starters.
I kind of would figure that, you know, Coach Hearn, I bet he will here in a little bit. He'll let the younger guys get a snap or two. And, you know, and like I said, kudos to both coaches. I mean, Coach Pete, Coach Hearn, both. I mean, they're both of them are class acts.
Yeah, strong right slot to the left. Motion by Alanis. There's Alvarado. Takes his pitch back to Francis. Francis looking downfield. Got a wide open receiver.
Golly, he did.
In Ortiz, and Ortiz catches it and falls in.
Right behind
for the touchdown.
Yeah, right behind Shuck. And, you know, we sit there and watch this and watch it develop. And yeah, nice throw and.
Yeah, there's two defenders down there close. Well,
and Shuck tried to slap the ball out of his hand, but was unsuccessful.
Alvarado on for the point after attempt. Oh, a snap high. Oh, this one's made
very
it for
good.
A silo. We'll
very
see if it gets
good.
There.
I was going to say, somebody has to kick a silo in a game. You got to
yeah,
get Tim
there. Yeah, there was no – that silo kick didn't go through, so unsuccessful point after. 4:32 left in this half. A 66-8 lead by the Silverton Owls, and we will take a break.
The State National Bank of Groom is a friendly hometown bank that believes in face-to-face banking. The State National Bank of Groom has been in business since 1904, and they know how to treat their customers right. State National Bank of Groom offers checking and savings accounts, certificate of deposits, safe deposit boxes, gift cards, online banking, along with commercial and personal loans. They are open Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. You can contact them at 806-248-7531 for the Bank and Groom, or 806-371-7100 for the Bank in Amarillo. They have 2 locations to serve you, 99 Broadway in Groom and the Amarillo branch at 101 Southeast 11th Avenue, Suite 100. The State National Bank of Groom, a bank you can trust in.
All right, we're back. The Owls have got their lead out to 66-8, kind of like you roll a watermelon down the road and it's going to get splattered. That's kind of what's happening to the Tigers.
And there's the kick. It's going to be a high floater.
Yeah, nice pickup by Pete. Pete running over to his left, trying to get a few blocks, and still on his feet. Down the left side.
He's got the edge.
Oh, and he's gone. Is he going to
go? Oh, he's tracked down from behind. But that was number six, Flores, that came up behind him and got him.
Yeah, one of the young guys, like I said, Coach Hearn letting the little guys get into play, but looked out there for a second. Pete was on his way to score.
I'm trying to figure out what that catch was. It was like a Rockettes kick that he did right before he took off. It was kind of fancy.
So it's a first and 15 for the Tigers. First and goal, correct. Yeah, first and goal for the Tigers. The ball is at about the 12-yard line. Tigers in a tight spread. Snap back to Pete. It's a quick little handoff back to Corley. Following a couple of blocks, he's trying to follow Ryan, but the Owls weren't fooled.
Yeah, that was both Beltran and Francis that got in there. And a couple of these numbers are new. I think Silverton slipped a couple of their guys in.
Probably did.
I'm having to – the number pops up, and I have no idea who it is. Now, he might have been in there the whole time, and I just haven't had the opportunity to call his name yet.
So, again, Tigers come up. It's going to be in a strong right. And a quick handoff to Pete. Ducks his head and got to about the 8-yard line.
Yeah, that's Francis that met him there in the middle of the field.
You know, a little positive yards for the Tigers, you know, finally down on this end of the field instead of the other end. So we got third and goal for the Tigers.
Ball's what, about the eight? Yep. 8 or 9?
Strong right. Treadwell's under center. Another quick handoff to Pete. This time he goes over the right side, still on his feet. And down to about the, looks like the 4, which will be fourth and goal.
He's grinding about 3 yards at a time.
Yep. Let's see what Coach Pete has.
I hope he gets 4 on this one.
Yeah. It'd be nice.
Yeah, it doesn't need the 3 this time.
We need the 4.
Clock continues to run.
We need the 4 for the 6. There
yes,
we go.
The 4 for the 6 to the 2 power.
Tiger's going to come up again in a strong right. Treadwell is under center. Pete, running back. Snap. It's a fake handoff, and he's got – oh,
my
–
who
guys.
Was he throwing to?
I think he was looking for Corley, and Shuck was wide
Shuck
open.
Shuck was
in the
wide
back.
Open on the back line. Oh, that was a fourth down play, too.
Yeah, turnover on downs. Owls will get the ball again.
So they'll have a first down play starting at the 4-yard line. Their own 4-yard line this time. 2:45 left in this half of play. Owls have a lead of 66-8. And it looks like Silverton's running in some new players, so I may be a little slow on the calls this time.
Yep.
You have to bear with me.
Like I said, you know, you're letting the young guys get a chance.
Yeah, Francis is out. Yeah.
And I don't mean to make fun of them, but it looks like a junior high team.
Yeah, these are all their young guys.
Yeah. These guys are small.
So they're in a short spread here.
I was going to say they
snap to that back, pitch back, and I'll try and catch these numbers in a minute. He's looking to throw the ball. He's running around. He's got a receiver over. Oh, and it is. This is Alvarado over here.
Okay.
And he's going to wind his way around to just inside the 10-yard line.
I was going to say they were probably going to make me eat my words because I told them they were little. And you know what? They almost did. So, yep.
So it's a six-yard gain. And, you know, he was catching a lot of pressure in the end zone.
Yep. Groom, their first of the half.
Okay. So
Groom calls a timeout.
What did they call timeout? We're going to thank some more of our sponsors. The grocery stores.
Yeah, Groom S&H.
Yeah, Groom S&H, Panhandle Thriftway, Claude, Johnny's. In Claude, I tell a lot of folks, you know, really lucky in these little small towns that, you know, you do not have to drive to Emerald or Pampa. Charlene does a really good job keeping prices very competitive. And like I said, it saves us the gas. I'm not having to go to United or anything like that. So thank you to Charlene and her crew.
Boer Enterprises, yeah. We have them here in town. All your tire needs, anything you need there, very easy to get along with. We appreciate their support. Williams Farms over out of Panhandle. Always good to have people from outside of our area that support what we're doing. Mm-hmm. We really appreciate that. All our little towns are tied together pretty tight.
Yep. And Witt Flooring, they are the sponsor of the official, the booth of.
That's right, the booth.
Yeah, the booth of the two guys that here.
So up to the line are the Owls. They're in a strong right with a slot to the right. Alvarado takes a snap, pitches back, catching a lot of pressure. They're trying to run him. I don't know how he didn't get tackled there,
but he's
going to have enough for the first down. And that's Ortiz that was the deep back on that one. And gets, it looks like he's going to have just enough to move the chains.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was just right there.
It was a good job, yes. Very good job, buddy.
So he gets out to the 19-yard line. 2:17 left in this half as they have a new set of downs, fresh set of downs for the Owls. They're going to have a first down play. Clock has stopped. He must have stepped out of bounds. They're in a short spread formation. Alvarado and Ortiz are the upbacks. Snap to Ortiz. Pitches back. I think that's all Anise.
Yep.
Yeah, I can tell by the way he's running.
They brought him back, so good job.
So he's going to get 5 yards on the play.
Yeah, brought down by Kenny Blackwell along number 32.
They're going to mark him 6. He gets all the way to the 25, so that'll bring up second down and 9. The clock will continue to run this time as they stayed in the field of play.
So and you know, this is something, you know, you hate for your home team to get beat like this, but it kind of wakes you up. You know, you realize, like, we need to do better because, you know, next week is not guaranteed either.
Yeah, got to step up.
Yeah, you got to step up.
Up in a spread, kind of a spread formation. Twins to the right, single lineman to the right as well. Alvarado's on the move. He comes in. They're going to run over this way. And that is Ortiz. Ortiz makes a little sidestep, just waited for that block to develop.
Yep.
And he gets a nice run all the way down to the 27, 28-yard line of the Tigers from the 25-yard line of the Owls.
And the clock will continue to run.
113, 112, and a new set of downs.
I think they are fixing to. Yeah.
He was just making sure that he didn't step out of bounds.
And it looks like, yeah, the Owls are probably – they're in their victory formation, and rightly so. And then Coach Pete's just telling them, hey, back off.
Yeah, they're going to kneel
it
down.
That's what they're going to do, yeah. So
we'll have one more snap before this is over, but it looks to me like Silverton Owls are going to take this game pretty handily, 66-8. We do have a small order of business to do here. We do select players of the game, and tonight we're going to have to give dual players of the game to Silverton. You know, Sawyer Francis played one heck of a game. And then playing on that defensive side of the ball, Zayden Ortiz, number 15, we're going to give him the other one because he really stifled the Tigers' Tigers offense.
And here's a little something. The last time the Tigers lost to Silverton and for a district who's going to be first and second was here. It was about four or five years ago.
Okay.
Jeff, 8 years ago. Oh, 2018. Okay, thanks, Jeff. So,
always seems like it comes down to being an important game.
It comes down to Groom and Silverton, so congratulations to the Owls. I got the birds right this time. I didn't call them Eagles. But join us next week. We're going to see we're going to Headley, but it's going to be one of these that
we don't know if the game is going to make or not.
Yeah, we don't know if they're going to have enough for a team. You know, it's sad that, you know, it's that way, but be sure to join us and we'll be here to call the game for you.
And I think if we don't have a game, we may pick another one and go somewhere else. Yeah, so be sure and tune in because we may surprise you with where we're at.
Yep.
So thank you for listening in. We'll catch you next week.
I'm going to go to the next one. Head. Head. Oh, head. Still go get it.
Yes, sir.